Everyone knows about the famous men in the American Revolutionary War. George Washington, Benedict Arnold, Alexander Hamilton, they're all well known. You know what's not well known? The women who helped out behind the scenes. Honestly, massive kudos to them. Back then, women had barely any rights. But when the revolution whirled around, oh boy, they were practicing responsibilities and rights everywhere. Wives of husbands who were at war assumed their position in their businesses and took care of business things. Throughout the war, they became used to their position and began to enjoy the idea of owning property and having responsibilities. On top of that, there was this group of women called the Daughters of Liberty. They were made up of females who were like, hey, I want to help out too! And boycotted British goods and started making their own products. The Daughters of Liberty included Martha Washington, wife of George Washington. Besides the Daughters of Liberty, there were also women who were related to the men in the war who helped out at camp by cooking meals, repairing uniforms, cleaning, taking care of the injured, and looking for food. Sometimes, though, these women took action at the battlefield itself. A famous example was Mary Ludwig Hayes, or Molly Pitcher. Her primary job was to give water to the thirsty and hot soldiers. However, one day her husband, William Hayes, was injured in action. And instead of continuing to pass out water, Molly Pitcher took over his role as a gunner. She later gained a pension for her wartime service. By the way, a pension is basically a payment that you receive for working somewhere. Okay, on with the show! Similarly to Molly, Margaret Corbin also stepped up to her husband's position. She was the wife of John Corbin, an artilleryman who was killed at Fort Washington. When her husband passed away, Margaret filled in his place at the cannon and started to help in with sponging and loading it. During this time, she became permanently disabled due to wounds in her arm and chest. Margaret Corbin became the first woman in America to be paid with a disabled veteran's pension. Some ladies even cross-dressed to join the fight. For example, there's Deborah Sampson of Massachusetts. She pulled a Mulan and dressed as a man to fight in the revolution. Deborah Sampson took on the name Robert Shurtleff as a pseudonym. She got injured at a fight in Tarrytown, New York. When Sampson went to the doctor to get her wounds healed, she didn't tell him about how a musket ball hit her thigh because that would
expose her!
So in a total kick butt and kind of gruesome move, she cut the bullet out of her leg herself and sewed the wound back up. Eventually, her true gender was revealed and she was discharged with honor and received a soldier's pension. Some women made an impact quietly along the sidelines. Phyllis Wheatley, an African-American slave in Boston, wrote poetry about independence. Her most famous collection of poems is Poems on Various Subjects, Religious and Moral. In addition to this, Wheatley also wrote a poem to George Washington titled To His Excellency, George Washington, in 1775. She even had the honor of reading it to Washington a year later. Phyllis Wheatley won her freedom the following year when her master passed away. Now that you've heard about a few of the many honorable women in the American Revolutionary War, let's discredit one famous woman's legacy. Betsy Ross, as you all know, is known for making the first American flag. But after some research, people found out that the story has pretty much no proof to it. It was most likely made up at the centennial of the Declaration of Independence in 1876 and was encouraged by Ross's grandson, William Carby. Women in the American Revolution had just as much of an impact as the men. From fighting, to boycotting goods, to just writing, female colonists definitely influenced the result of the American Revolutionary War.